Welcome, everybody, to the Rainbow Six North American League. As you may have noticed, we're starting a little bit late. Apologies for the delay, but it took some time to get things online this morning. Tech delays, you know, you have rainstorms in other sports. You got tech delays in esports. It's just how it goes. But things have been moving right along here at the Rainbow Six League. Either way, we've got our maps lined up for our first match between Space Station Gaming and Astralis. Want to get some quick thoughts on that. Jacob, we'll start with you.
I mean, look, I really like Astralis, but I think Space Station have definitely been on a little bit more of an upward swing, so to speak. Right. A lot of questions about exactly where Astralis is meant to be sitting. I think the bank choice is definitely probably meant to work in Astralis' favor a little bit. I feel like that should do more for them in the long run, but Space Station look like a really complete team right now. Game should be pretty good.
Yeah, I agree. I think, you know, bank's a strong map for both these teams, and I think we're going to get a treat, but I think SSG is the better team, and on bank, I think you need to be the better team.
Yeah, right now, Space Station Gaming, the best defensive team in the league, 70%. Bank does lean towards the attackers a little bit more, so if there's something Astralis can get going there on the attack, it is a tough nut to crack SSG's defenses, but this might just be what helps them push them over the edge and perhaps get in there with the offense.
That's right. So obviously, we wish we could go a little bit more in depth, but we got to move along. The players are waiting. Here's how the predictions lined up, and look at that. The coin, the only one to not pick Space Station Gaming. I had witnesses when I flipped it. It's true. Jesse
I wasn't there.
I was there.
He saw it, though.
It was Tails.
Jesse saw it. Some of our production people saw it. And, you know, would I really want to lie and pick that anyway? I don't know.
You can just tell us. Yeah,
congratulations to SSG for winning this game based on the coin curse, by
exactly.
the way.
There you go. That is, we do have historical evidence to back that up. And that's to say, Astralis is still a strong team, but like you were saying, they just don't seem to have it together this stage yet. We'll see if they can maybe put that together now. But I believe that we are already ready to send it over to our casters to get this map started. Once again, thanks for waiting. Let's get the games underway. Pengu and Intero, take it away.
Well, thank you very much. A long delay, but it's Astralis versus Space Station. Two interstellar teams, if we'd like to say that.
Sure.
Actually, very yeah. topical, given what we saw with NASA driving the rocket into the asteroid. Did you watch that?
I saw the clips of it afterwards.
A first for humanity.
Yeah.
Incredible stuff. And hopefully this match is equally as thrilling. For those of you that weren't following along, NASA decided to pilot a rocket into a meteor slash asteroid to see if it could be deflected. I don't actually know what the result was. I think it said it would take a couple days to know. But either way, very cool stuff. Humanity won. Asteroids and dinosaurs zero. So either way, we're not going to delay anything.
Oh, shuttle.
Just like right now, DP Fire delayed that fist bump from shuttle. Let's get underway with our very first matchup. Thank you again for your patience. Space Station versus Astralis. Go to bank.
Interesting map choice for these teams. Both teams they played, of course. And of course, it speaks to the dynamic capabilities of both Space Station and Astralis, because you can do so much both from the attacking side and the defending side. And SSG, right off the bat, they're going to remove that operator of Nook, because again, such a big open map. Poll on your screen, if your life depended on performance, who would you pick? Hot and Cold or Iconic? That's a good one, actually, because Hot and Cold, of course, he owned the NAL for quite a while earlier in this year. Iconic, he's had his moments, especially at the Charlotte Major.
I mean, I would go with Hot and Cold.
Yeah?
Just in like terms that? Of consistency, I would go with Hot and Cold.
Okay.
Iconic was very consistent at the Charlotte Major, yes.
Yes.
Nobody was particularly consistent at the Berlin Major. Forrest, I think, was their standout player. And then so far through this stage, Iconic has had moments of greatness. But again, he has not been the most consistent. Operator bans are in. A Zofia ban. That is a bit abnormal. We don't tend to see a lot of those.
Yeah, I'm trying to think really quickly in my head, like, what could this specifically mean? But I wouldn't go so far as to say it's like Zofia is going to be a massively impactful operator for a strategy on bank, so to speak, but it could speak to the comfortability of their opponents by just removing that operator from the board, you know, forcing them onto Ashe as a substitute, which has like worse recoil or not as big of a zoom scope, or again, just like the comfortability of the player who plays that specific operator. So Charlotte's betting Zofia Valkyrie and SSG betting the Nook and the Asami. And it's also SSG starting on defense, and they're bringing out quite the lineup right now. They got the post for information and the castle for that extended roam upstairs, because when you are playing on bank, you can't just sit on the bombs anymore. This is not year one, year two Pro League. It is not that simple any longer. And if you were to want to do that, you would need a ton of bomb deny, right? The Echo, the Maestro, the Smoke, maybe a Goyo. And that's not what we're seeing from Space Station. They're bringing out the more capable roaming operators. Mute Jammers to slow down that drone information. Castle Bakers to stop lines of sight and kind of restructure how you can approach the map. And of course, you still got Bosco and Smoke who can hold down the bomb set alone if he needs to with those toxic canisters. So Astralis, they got quite a job ahead of them. And because Sophia is off the board from Astralis themselves, they are indeed bringing the Ashe here in round number one. It's J9O who's going to lead the charge on that particular operator.
The telltale sounds of the DMR. And it's not the DMR you would expect. The Buck DMR, the Camers, C-A-M-R-S.
Yes.
I don't know enough about guns because as a Canadian, we don't really have that same culture up there. But I will say, I know that there are certain liberties that get taken with the names of weapons because they are not the actual names, the proper names of them all. DP Fire is down, by the way, very quickly. DP Fire decided to go towards Garage, or even could have been on Repel, and gets shot down by the pulse of Rampy. Rampy had a terrible game yesterday, and he tweeted out that there's no excuse. He just simply needs to be better.
Yeah, and I mean, it's hard to stay consistent in Rainbow Six Siege, especially when you play a variety of roles. And Rampy, not always necessarily on the pulse operator, but for spacing, he's been trying to step up on the defensive side to play more of a flexibility role. Shuttle really struggling to buck at you right now, getting open the walls, and of course that hard hatch earlier on. But Astralis making rather quick work off the roam clear right now, forcing SSG back at about a minute and 45 seconds. But the thing is, because Rampy found that kill earlier onto DP Fire, that just means that you can actually fall back early. You've already bought yourself an advantage elsewhere on the scoreboard, and now you have less to deal with as the attack and lineup. I mean, you lose your second Heart Breacher. All you have now are two Excalibur Pellets from Forest and one single can opener from Shuttle. You can't really attack server that comfortably with only those few pieces of Heartbreach utility. So I have to wonder now what Astralis are going to do, because it looks like they have to drop a hatch in desperation because they can't get everything opened up that they would like to.
That's a very good point. 1 minute left, still tussling with the castle barricades. All of the hatches have been reinforced and the Buck keeps going to every single one of them, and much to Shuttle's dismay, he finds himself staring at hatches that have been reinforced, and he's not able to get them open with the skeleton key. Instead, the good thing for the Buck is that can opener that you talked about, the secondary hard breach gadget. He's still got two X-Kairos pellets. That's not enough to open up a hatch from Forest, so desperation does seem to be the name of the game here. But nice pick by J9O on the Fultz. Flashes go down. SSG is waiting for the drop. I don't know what's going on with Yeti's name. It's a bit confusing. Hot and Cold picks up a kill as well. The UMPs seemingly working wonders for Space Station as they're both of the kills, and Forest is no more. Forest, the most consistent player on Astralis so far this stage. J9O falls next, and now in the midst of the smoke is Iconic, who gets torn to shreds and finished off by Yeti, who's putting up a really nice piece of work. And the final three kills are all his, and he shows it off on camera. Space Station take round number one.
I love Yeti. But I think putting Yeti near your opponents and sort of like side of the table is always going to bring you like a small advantage here, because he's always going to be taunting them. And you're up against Astralis, and we see them every single week, and especially at a major event like the Charlotte Major in person, where they will get really loud, and Iconic, of course, will stand up and, of course, also taunt towards his opponents. So I like that kind of chemistry you can have of fighting between two teams and the mental warfare. And that's something that a lot of players speak about when Yeti joined SSG for Stage 3, is that he brings good vibes. He's a very vocal, charismatic person. He has that aura, if you will, to bring up the energy and to keep things going round and round, one at a time. And that's something that Space Station, they've kind of struggled with in the past, where sometimes when things don't go their way, we tend to call them like an emotional team, if you will, where they can tilt, they can get upset, as can any team. But I think Yeti has been a great addition for Space Station in this particular department, where it's like, next round, we got it. Just focus on this one. And then one round at a time, they can slowly make that comeback work. And they've done it twice already in the first five games here in the NAL of Stage 3. Upstairs, completely different story from downstairs. We're going to be setting up deployable shields, reinforcing certain walls, so we establish like a stronghold. Fultz in this very stable position outside the stock double door. Bolo from GSM also plays here. You just hold down this area as long as possible and stall for time.
I'm glad you pointed that out, because when we casted TSM on Bank just a couple days ago, well, I guess it would have been last week, still a couple days, this setup that we saw by the trading wall, where the deployable shield is, was so critical for TSM's holds and proved to be a significant challenge to flush Bolo out of that spot. Yep. Space Station might not invest the same amount of effort into it if they feel like they're getting pressured by Astralis quite early. And the big thing for Astralis is they've got the pressure magnet himself of Montaigne. You can flush so many people out of their spots as that mountain just continues to move towards you.
I do like the Monty on a CEO attack. You're pretty much forced to go for a lobby attack, which is what Forest is also looking for right now. Going Skylight is difficult with the C4s, the verticality, the crossfires, but if you go for this lobby side attack, you can just walk up that red staircase, use your smoke grenades if you want to, cut a line of sight and kind of help your teammates walk behind you to get up, because it's so difficult to get up past that point of pressure. That's where Yeti's playing right now, holding top main. Of course, we got mirror windows in their direction as well, so Astralis is not an easy task ahead of them, but they got the right tools to deal with it. The Twitch, the Smokes, the Monty, the Flores, tons of utility.
The Monty's going to continue to walk up those main stairs. You can hear the sound of the built-in suppressor,
camera?
But I think that's a yokai, is it? Oh, no, that is
that
a default,
is the default camera.
They've left the default up in main lobby. Tisk, tisk.
Ooh.
Astralis, you have to be better than this. For a second there, it looked like Yana. There we go. Jane, I know, finally gets some sensibility. But Fultz will take full advantage of this. He knows that the Yana is scouting up. He sees the Montane, but cannot connect and do even a single point of damage. There were two targets for Fultz, two tasty morsels. He couldn't accomplish either of them. It's going to allow Astralis to move uncontested up, but hot and cold swings through the now ejected mirror window. Down goes Fultz to the Montane Forest, unsheathing the pistol and doing some serious damage in the process. Now it's Iconic to try and tussle with Rampy, but Forest picks up his second kill.
Two Monty kills in one round, both ADSing in. Now the XU combo still beats Rappel in. C4 goes out. It misses.
Unlucky for Bosco amidst the smoke. Now there goes the rest of the mirror window. Hot and cold, swung on by Shuttle. I don't think they knew he was in there. Bosco to try and salvage the round, and now Yeti gets one too, but he gets punished by Iconic. Bosco with just a single point of HP. Any bullet through the wall will be his undoing. This is not exactly the position that he wants to find himself in. No HP, no utility, and a gun that'll run out of bullets very, very quickly. The good news is that a single bullet from that weapon will kill Iconic. That'll leave DP Fire in the position to plant with 20 seconds left. And there it goes, starting the diffuser down. Bosco will need to retake, but he's Mira. He's gonna make a ton of noise in the process, and he has no idea where they're looking. Through the wall, he could shoot the ace, but he doesn't have ESP like we do. The countdown timer continues, 35 seconds. Bosco has no idea. He's going to make noise every single time he crouches, every single time he leans. Small sounds that will be heard by Astralis as they sit pretty in DP Fire, knows he's coming, and gets the kill. Astralis finally answer back.
Nice discipline there in that 1v2 from Astralis as well, because it just, you know, they will choose a corner, sit there, and play off that audio like you mentioned, because, well, they might not know where Bosco was exactly, but he's going to be making a ton of noise working through the map. And they knew he was 1 HP by the looks of it, because that pre-fire coming out indicated that they're going for the buddy. They just want to get that one bullet, and then they get the round. And top floor, it is a difficult one to defend. All those long lines of sight, but that's not even what the problem was for Space Station. We didn't really see it on screen specifically, but Forest getting two kills with Monty, both headshots, I assume they're both ADS, that's a problem. You're giving the Monty not just a 1v1 gunfight, but you're also losing them with a real gun in your hands. So Forest might have had a crazy outplay, I'm not sure, but he really carried them throughout that round in that first minute and a half. In Space Station, they think differently of it. They're going to change the bump set around to open area instead, which I think favors their playstyle more. It speaks to the same way you played the basement. You can roam, you can play across the entirety of the map. You can play the basement, upstairs, top floor. It's just about where you want to be, not where you have to be. And of course, SSG can do the classic one person or maybe two people on the bump set can hold down the fort and enable the more aggressive players to do their thing on the roam. Love the Maestro on open area. So much information can be gained, drones can be shot. And we've seen some historic clutches with that particular operator in open air in the past as well. It was hot and cold in a 1v4. Quite a remarkable clutch back in the past.
I mean, if you think about the players that are in this lobby, you've got a ton of clutch potential.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, just on Space Station's side, the amount of clutches we've seen from Bosco and hot and cold could very easily fill out a grand montage, but they don't play for DZ, so I don't know if he's going to do that. As for Astralis, Forest has clutched, Iconic has clutched, Shuttle has clutched. Speaking of Shuttle, hunting down one player from Space Station, but it's a coordinated effort as Jane, I know, gets credited with the kill. Fultz 1-2, but Forest answers back. Within 45 seconds, three people laid to rest, and now the Mute will join as well. A DMR bucked us so much damage, and Shuttle is putting it to good use. From above, two picks. Rampy will end that reign of terror. There's 2 minutes left. There's only three players up in the server. This has been absolute pandemonium.
the pacing of this round is absolutely absurd, especially on Bank of all things, because like normally we don't see this kind of fast-paced play style, but also that's not the bump site. The bump site's downstairs. We're doing a fast take on top floor to sweep out the roamers and shuttle. He thrived in that chaos and found two kills for his team. Rambi, I will say, in a great position to clutch out for his team. They got those evil eyes from Maestro, they got information on the bomb side. He's got a decent gun for this position. He has got that 1.5x zoom scope. He does have the UMP fire rate being low. Rambi, of course, is a player that we know can hit his shots when it matters the most.
Yet again, these are the same two players on Astralis that clutched out in the previous round.
Oh, I like this.
Little known fact about Candelas, they can go through floors, and it's always a surprise when people see that happen. As you can stick them through walls, you can stick them through the floors. Iconic will now try to capitalize off of this late blind. Rampy inside of the bomb site, and the pacing is just all over the place. There's an avenue to get away, but Iconic does not allow Rampy to escape, and Astralis gains the lead.
Yeah, and again, as you said, the pacing, I said this recently on a stream of mine, but
did you?
Whenever you're in a 1v2 or 1v3, like we just saw from Astralis, I think the best thing you can do is do nothing, right? Just sweat out Rampy in that 1v2, let the adrenaline fade away, make him get out of that, you know, primal instinct clutch zone, so to speak. And when the pressure was applied to Rampy, we had to make that decision, he ran. He 180'd, ran the small box and vault, like jumped through a rotate where he can't turn around, he can't fight back, got shot from, you know, in the back itself, and he just died. So I like when you sweat people out, you take your time. They throw a candela somewhere, they don't really act upon it, they throw a smoke somewhere, they don't really act upon it, they just take their time. Huge fan of that mental warfare in the 1v2s. It's so easy to throw around just running at your enemy and like he's feeling it, right? He's hitting his shots, he's doing good. It's so hard to win when you just play the clock and make him sweat for it. And back downstairs, the one bomb site, that space station day one, the very opening round is where we are once more. Different lineup, the Pulse and the Castle not in play. Instead the Goyo and a C4 from Yeti. And you said Yeti's name, he did the caps lock on caps lock, like letter for letter, and I'm not sure why, but that's his name today. It's Yeti SSG. That's what I would go about it.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I appreciate you shining a light on exactly how you would go about his name. It's what do they call it? The camel typing or something like that? Shuttle's dead, by the way, to Yeti.
Okay.
SSG. And now Bosco takes out Forest. Astralis falling by the wayside as they've lost two players in the first 30 seconds. Almost every single one of these rounds has been defined by these early picks, Nicholas.
Yep. The thing is, in the first round, it was Space Station get that opening kill.
Very early.
On DP Fire, no response. And then the following two rounds, it was a trade back and forth from both teams, so there was no real advantage being made with the opening kill. But now in round number four, we're finding ourselves in that same position. SSG, they get a pick or two, and now we're chilling. They're all back on the bomb side, they give up the roam clear 2 minutes. Iconic, he just stops the hatch on the side, he injures his teammate! Man!
That was messy. Very, very messy.
This match is something. I like it.
This
match
is something. What the hell is going on?
You're 3v5. You got a full center. The Church Drone wasn't shot. He thought they had no information. And it looked great on paper, but then the execution was just really, really wonky with that injury onto Jayne. I know. It happens.
As you pointed out, that early pick onto DP Fire was what set the chain of events in motion back in round number one. He was the first to die. No response from Astralis. Now, he's last alive. Oh, how the turntables. And it looks like he's going to take a timeout, by the way.
Yeah.
So this is very common. You saw a litany of team timeouts being taken yesterday. Basically, you know that the round is unwinnable. In a 1v4 with no utility remaining other than two breach charges, the likelihood of DP Fire pulling off a clutch against Space Station on a bottom floor defense is nil. There's just no way. Space Station will hold every crossfire, and the moment you try to breach the bomb site, they're going to find you and punish you for it. So what is DP Fire going to do? He's going to sit there. He might eventually die at the tail end of the round, but he's going to allow the team to talk through what happens next.
Yeah.
Yeah, they can't talk with their coach, but they can still discuss the intricacies of rounds 5 and 6 and move forward. It also prevents them from having to take attack timeout. They might still take one, but this is effectively working as a timeout. I'm sure Space Station is using the same time that is available to strategize, but this is a boon for Astralis, and DP Fire is just going to buy time and wait and let the leaders on Astralis do their thing.
Yeah, and I'm sure some people are going to be in chat be like, oh, but Parker, every round is winnable. I've seen a 1v5 before, and technically you're right. Every round is winnable, and DP Fire could just walk on in and just get four headshots and the round is over, as shots I take it, whatever. But there's like a statistically unwinnable scenario, and this is one of those where like statistically this is not a winnable round, and it will not be. Impex get tossed out, fire at the ground, and of course Forceman flank above. It's a 2-2 tied up game right now, but SSG, they take both basement defenses.
A cacophony of noise and explosions ring out around DP Fire, but ultimately, the elevator lift, the elevator shaft, whatever you'd like to call it, is his grave. Space Station resolute on these two CCTV defenses that they've had so far. Now the problem becomes, which bomb site do you go to next?
Yeah.
They failed at that upstairs CEO defense in large part because they conceded lobby, were not able to slow the Montane down, and then because the Monty continued to take map control away from them, it boxed Space Station out, put them back into Janitor, put them back into CEO, and then Astralis just swung in through the windows and clobbered you from within. Open area was not any better. If you recall, seven players of the 10 in the server died in the first 40 seconds. So things fell apart for SSG very, very quickly. They're going to gamble back on CEO upstairs. One bomb site that has not been played is Archives Tellers on the main floor. I don't know if it'll show up or not. Again, a tisk, 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 a wag of the finger. Because Space Station likes to go to all four of the bomb sites. But they didn't do that yesterday.
I was going to say they
did not do that yesterday.
Disappointed.
It really got me, okay? It got my goat. It really got my goat.
Okay.
It's a turn of phrase, okay?
Yeah.
Maybe they don't have that in Denmark.
I've never heard that before.
Oh,
it's, no surprise that Forest brings back the Monty with that success that they had last time. I like Shuttle on the line as well, just to kind of help emphasize that, you know, if you can box somebody in somewhere, just make them stand still as well. I feel that pressure of the red pings coming out from the scanner. Similar push now, as Forest and Geno are hovering towards the lobby side. And SSG now, specifically Rambi and Bosco and Yeti, the three people on the west-hand side, the left side of our screen, they're the front players for this attack. I assume that they continue for this front side push. They have to stand their ground and try and establish a crossfire to punish Forest and the Monty. Otherwise, that's where Astralis will get in successfully, just like the last time around. The thing is, Astralis, they are rotating around, either trying to apply some phantom pressure, just opening up doors and windows and keeping them guessing. But the thing is, when you got the Monty, he's kind of loud.
Well, get one change that they've made, though. They've got the Lion to bring in to go with it. So if you're dealing with a Monty staring you down, and Astralis have established crossfires, and EE1D forces you, to make a decision. Do you engage with the Montane? Do you potentially wait to die as he continues his advance? Or do you get out of there right into the waiting arms of somebody else? J9O vaults right in. Fultz decides to gamble it, gets the pick onto J9O. There's another down by the hallway.
SSG, nice shot.
They're just snapping necks and cashing checks. Rampy goes down to Forest. It's the same position, but it's Forest alone to deal with the rest of Space Station. There's still Frostmats up as well. I actually think now all of them have been taken care of, so Forest doesn't have to watch where he walks, but things are going to get pretty dicey. Fultz a big round, and again, this breakneck pace, trying to make up for all the time that we had to delay earlier today as Space Station and Astralis are speedrunning this matchup. SSG takes the lead, though.
That they are. Rambi died the exact same way as last time. It's like proning on the floor, not really fighting back against the Monty. And I like this, you know, aggressive pushman shot. As DP5 opens up the window, and then you got your Ayana just jumping in through that window of DP Fire. And then things just get really, really messy because you didn't have time to check for frost traps. They saw two of them were in the lobby side. They probably assumed that that third trap would be elsewhere. But the thing is, there's two windows. So had you jumped in the other stock window, that entire push might go differently, but it's the wrong choice. So it happens when you have no information to work with. Now Space Station's final defensive round, in regulation at least, it's going to be open area, where they got rushed the last round, but the Doke could be the Lion. Shuttle got that double kill, and then SSG fell apart. Ramping the 1v2 could not win it out for SSG. Going 3-3 on bank, both teams can be happy with it. Of course, Space Station would love a 4-2 split to go to the attack inside. And as JC said on the desk, Space Station is the number one defensive team right now in the NAL, with like, I believe it's a 70% or 60% win rate on defense.
But bank skews towards the attackers, as Jesse also pointed out. So
yeah,
you
exactly
have a good defensive team on a map that tends to be favorable to the attackers.
Mm-hmm.
And what ends up happening? Well, it becomes a struggle for Space Station to see if they can maintain that composure and success on defense. So far, so good, but there's still one more round.
Yep. Next could make or break it. Now, it looks like Astralis are slowing down their pace for this round. No rush is occurring, no land on the board. Of course, Iconic is on the Duke AB. Last time, they were applying all this pressure on top of the CO windows. They threw in the Candelas, they rappelled in, and then things just got really explosive. Right now, we're droning, waiting, trying to gain information as to where the members of SST will be playing. And Rambi, once again, finding himself on the floor of all places, just holding the skylight.
Obviously, very similar to what we used to see on console at Bank, defined a ton by its repel play. If CEO is where you want to take hold of, and it certainly is on this open area defense. First logic bomb goes off, and a mini EMP as well will follow. Look at Rampy in this rat position. DP fire cut down by Fultz. I don't know if he was over by the skylight or not, but Rampy pops up, and he's having a much better game than he did yesterday. And with it, the fortunes of SSG seem quite favorable. Yeti now taking down Forest as it leaves Shuttle and Iconic as the only two players still standing from Astralis to contend with the entire team of Space Station.
Yeah, and knowing SSG, they're all going to fall back in safe positions like bomb site in the basement because they're not going to give up any free kills on the top floor. They no longer need this space on the map. They've gained what they wanted. Three kills to their name. Diffuser, I mean, you can see through the wall. It's outside the CO windows. Nowhere to be found for Astralis. It's another messy round.
Shuttle in the same position, upstairs inside a janitor, paper, whichever you'd like to call it. He gets a fairly easy pick. He got two from that same spot before. That DMR really does hit like a truck. Iconic walks in, a weaker DMR in his hands, cannot contend against Yeti. Yeti also having a very strong game. The supporting cast from Space Station showing up in spades, obviously buoyed by the fact that Rampy seems to have returned to form. Shuttle's position is given away, and then he's finished off by Yeti, as we talked about. A huge first half for Yido as he gets 8 kills, and Space Station walks away with it 4-2 as we switch sides.
Yeah, now we gotta see what does Space Station's attacks look like, because it's always easier to defend an attack on almost every single map. I don't think Bank is that different, because if you're not approaching the map correctly, as saw in that final round from Astralis, it's just so hard to gain a foothold once you lose that first or second member of your team. There are so many different angles to cover, and you have almost no people to do it with. So you really gotta make the most of the 5v5 scenario, try and push that early advantage, and then like play from there. The aggression from SSG really paying off. They're winning their gunfights, and they're playing well together. I mean, Rambi is hiding in the rat corner, you can argue, sure, but he did that with two team members helping him out. One guy was bottom skylight, one guy was top skylight. They killed the initial drone, baited Astralis in, Rambi pops up, gets a free kill, and runs away. It's coordinated teamwork, and it's premeditated from the beginning of the round. That's the big difference there between that and an actual rat play, just hoping for a missed drone.
A very similar lineup from SSG being brought out to tackle this bomb site that's been played now twice before. Space Station lost it the first time they defended it, won it the second time, and now it's Astralis' first attempt on their very first defense. A Finca coming out for SSG, and a Lion as well, and a Ying. SSG in the final moments of the Operator repick blew up this lineup that at one point had a Sledge, a Zero, and a Thermite. Instead of going for more utility, this is a frag-heavy lineup that's coming out. No nades available, so all of the killing will be direct rather than indirect, but this could be a quick one, as SSG have already taken up space on Repel outside of the CEO windows.
Yep, and there's no Warden for Astralis. I mean, they got the mirror windows, which might bring them some value, but they can be dealt with. You know, the Hibana X cars can burn through the castle barricade, and the mirror window position is compromised, and Astralis, they're looking worse for wear, and there it is already in the first minute. The biggest issue that SSG had to deal with has been dealt with. Now, Ying and Lion can do their job with the Candelas and the Lion Scan. You can start executing in towards the bomb site, and this mirror window in janitors or meeting to janitors gives you almost no value because you reinforce the wall next to it.
Well, it could have been quick. That's what the assumption was here. Space Station do love this Ying an awful lot, so much so that it is often target banned by their opponents. Not this time. We'll see what havoc can be wreaked by those four Candelas and the two smokes that are brought in as well. And I like that you note that there is no Warden in play. So if Space Station decide to smoke off a bomb site, and not, I don't mean a bomb site as in like a single bomb site, I mean the actual A bomb site, which is what the goal seems to be, then you've got a frenzy on your hands. Bosco in, planting amidst the smoke in a safe position. A nitro cell could come out, but it won't. Space Station sweeping through Astralis. Jane and O taking damage as Astralis have lost two of their players. And Bosco sits over top of the diffuser before taking up space inside of Janitor. SSG still on rappel, waiting for a jump out. Astralis know that they are in desperate times. A flash goes out from Rampy to give the position away on rappel. Forrest inside a lobby, stopped, and well, he's picked apart by the pitter-patter of Yeti's gun. Astralis cannot do anything right now, and unless Iconic can start picking up some kills, this will be a flawless finish to the very first round for Space Station. Iconic can't do anything, by the way, and Space Station does do so flawlessly, taking their very first round on attack and continuing to build their lead over Astralis. They're now up 5-2.
And they do it in such a beautiful fashion. I mean, Astralis, they had that reinforced wall inside of Janitor's, and then the Mirror Node got put down, I can't really see anything. And Bosco made a great decision of where to plant. He ran deep into the bomb site, did not plant in that default position, and therefore he juked out the C4 from Iconic, and well, Astralis had no real information to work with. It was guesswork from below. That's forced Astralis to take their tactical timeout now, which I think, look at the round score being 5-2 in SSG's favor. It makes sense to do it now because if things keep going this way, well, you look at a match point rather soon. With a flawless execute like that from SSG, you need something else to throw at them to really make it difficult because you said it, Parker, the Ying is on the board. It's almost always banned on every single map, but this time it's not. In the very first round, it cost them.
Well, I mean, Operator Repick is still available, so this lineup isn't going to hold for Space Station if they don't want it to, but there is a Ying showing for Yeti. Yet again, this Operator could be a staple, but SSG did blow up that composition right before the end of the previous round's timer, so it's possible that they can swap off. This is technically Astralis' second timeout, the only one they're able to talk to their coach on, but if you recall,
yeah.
Back on the second attempt on that CCTV lockers bomb site down below, back in round four, DP Fire took about a minute and 30 seconds of just sitting there, letting his team talk to each other and go over the next steps. And I'm not sure it helped at all because Astralis has not been able to win a single round since that happened. Will this timeout pay dividends? We await. But you are teetering towards the abyss right now if you're Astralis. Oh. They are already in bad shape in terms of the standings. The likelihood of them making the fall major is very slim given how top-heavy the NAL has been and how consistent the top teams have been. But a win by either Astralis or Space Station could throw some upheaval into the scene. Right now, it does not look good for Astralis. Space Station looking like the more practiced team, but there's plenty of time for Astralis to turn this around.
Plenty of time there is, but the thing is, SSG, they've blown up their lineup once more. They changed all five operators. No real harpers on the board. Sure, Bosco, he's got the secondary harpers, the can openers that we say. But for open air, that's not going to give you that much value. I mean, you can get you can get two hatches, but the walls and bottom skylight, not going to happen. And when the finger's on the table and the line, it's usually going to be aggressive. We see two members on the rooftop. We're going to drop down a skylight and get really aggressive here for SSG. It's going to be an early execute for them.
And there goes a Candela and a hop in very quickly on. Yeti capitalizing off of it. Breaking double digits, looking for more. Astralis falling by the wayside. Iconic, the only kill, but
Yeti?
It's a triple kill from Yeti. He's feeling one today. What are they feeding this man? 2 minutes to go, and it's J9-0 in a 1v4. SSG moments away from moving to match point. Look at J9-0 accomplished. Downstairs inside of open area, flirting with the main stairs, watching the hatch. A single target is all to be had before his position is given away, and SSG can corral themselves and possibly capitalize off of that pick.
I mean, SSG returned the favor for Rambi's 1v2. They're sweating J9-0 out right now, just droning, blinds comes out, you can't really fight back, drops in the hatch.
Oh, and he misses the opportunity as they drop like frogs through the hatch. Yeti, a 4K! Almost getting every single kill. He's just racking them up. And that's match point for Space Station.
I mean, Yeti really is being unleashed in the last couple of games from Space Station. He's just having these moments where I feel like when I used to watch Yeti back on Sonic, it was more of like a lurking role he was doing, right? He would stab people in the back, go from across the map, crouch walk around, and maybe somehow disrupt the enemy team. But right now, it's Yeti actually leading the charge for SSG, enabling the execute, going in as the first entry, and finding not just one or two kills. He found three in that round, dropping a skylight half-blinded by the Yin Candela. But the thing is, what SSG essentially did, is that they will throw out the Incandela, blind the enemy and themselves. But when you pop the Finger Boost, the Adrenal Surge, you remove any blind effects upon yourself, just like with the Warden gadget. So it looked like Yeti got Team Flashed, and technically he did, but because Fos was on the Fink and because of the timing of the gadget, well, Yeti could still see in that gunfight against the Alibi, even though she could not. And just guarantees the kill and becomes so much more simple for the initial opening for them. Basement is on the menu, it's match point. As you see, are guaranteed 1 point at, you know, at worst if they go to OT. But looking at how well they're playing right now and how much the Stars are struggling to figure them out, I don't think we need overtime for this one, Parker.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna agree with you on this one. I do not see a way for Astralis to push us to overtime given how they've played up to this point. Struggling on defense through these two rounds, only getting a single kill on defense. That's it for Astralis. And that is just simply not good enough through these two rounds. And I mean, it started off with a tempo that is hard for Space Station to maintain, but they seem to carry it over from round 7 into round 8. Now as we're on round 9, bit of different tools being brought from Space Station. They do like this Pain Train style of lineup. There's no Ying present, but they've got a Blitz instead. So blinding potential for SSG is still very much there. And Hot and Cold is looking to go off to the races, but there's a crossfire established from Astralis that stops him in his tracks. And it looks like Astralis might have rebuffed that early push.
Yeah, it's a really good hold there. Denaro playing a nice position with the systems and the shotgun in open area. And now SSG, they got to change their approach. The thing is, when your attacking team, they change their pace, as a defender, you're thinking, where are they going to go? They were just here, three members, so they must still be nearby. But all of a sudden, well, Force is top floor. There's a player of SSG on the lobby side as well. And now Astralis have to re-figure out where all these player positions are. That's when things get difficult. With Valkyrie being banned off the board, you don't have any external information to figure out the exact whereabouts. So now it's a guessing game. SSG still have half the round to work with. They do have the Ibana, they can get every single hatch they want. And because Bosco's on the Thermite, they can even take server. A nice drop from Ramp, he gets one. That's the room clear. Done.
Astralis has not had a single uncontested first blood in this entire match. And they're just going to feed themselves to Fultz at this point, who picks up one kill. Can't get more than that, though. If an Adrenal Surge is available, Fultz will be able to pick himself up. Oh. And oh no, J9-0, here comes the pain! Hot and Cold brings it right to you. And it's Iconic in a 1v5. Yet again, Space Station have not suffered a casualty up to this point in this round. 1 minute to go, and Iconic is just going to go and try to get a pick for posterity's sake. But it ends flawlessly for Space Station. Good Lord, we just attended a funeral, it seems. 7-2 for Space Station on attack. They only had one person die. That's it. That's about as dominant as it can get. A disappointing day for Astralis. A disappointing week for Astralis, in fact, the result yesterday. But for Space Station, that is a huge mood booster. They pick up all 3 points and very quickly have set us back on schedule.
It's extremely impressive to watch because normally we see a very default style of Rainbow Six Siege. This entire attack inside from Space Station was anything but default. So huge props to them for sticking it through, keeping up the pace, really controlling everything on the attack inside. Very few teams can do it so well as they did in this particular matchup. It was really fun to watch.
I mean, it was an exciting match just to spectate, and if you like Space Station, you're obviously going to be very happy with those results. For fans of Astralis, you will very quickly try to forget that this matchup even happened.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're a fan of Astralis, though, at least you're buoyed by the fact that they will be present at SI, barring the most incredible, disastrous results. Astralis is going to be there. They're going to have to sort their stuff out before they get to SI, though. That is the problem, because if this team, as they look right now, goes to the Six Invitational, it might be a short-lived trip to, assuming it's Montreal or wherever, it might end up being. Either way, that's it for our very first match. We got a break ready for you, and then we'll come back. There's still four more to go, so sit tight. We'll be back in just a few minutes.
Welcome back to the Rainbow Six North American League Analyst Desk. Your host, Doa, here, along with Caliber Jacob, Jesse J. Chick, and our special guest, Pro Gamer Penguin, here to add some extra Pro Gamer-minded analysis to the desk. But that one was pretty short and sweet, wasn't it? That was a stompening. We got Yeti standing by over in Vegas to chat with us. Yeti, how's it going? Sometimes you just kind of roll over them. It was a fast, quick match. Congrats on the win. I kind of want to ask you about Astralis, though. I mean, we know there's a ton of good players on that team. In your opinion, what's going on with that team right now?
I mean, I think the funny thing to say would be they're saving strats for Invite because they've already qualified for it.
Sure.
So, I mean, at the end of the day, like, they don't need these points. They basically just be playing to win for their own, like, legacy, if you will. But, like, I mean, it's a stage. A lot of teams have bad stages. I mean, look at OXG. Look at Sonic stage one this year. It happens. I mean, they're all great players, and they all have really competitive mindsets. So I don't think it's, like, anything to harp on too hard.
Fair enough.
Yeti, I wanted to deep dive a little bit about your open area defenses. You played the first time in round number three. You guys got kind of rolled over very fast. It wasn't the greatest of rounds for you. Then you ran it back in round six. You made some adjustments. Can you talk a little bit about what you wanted to change from rounds three to six to make open area a bit of a better site for you guys?
I would say maybe give Bosco a more, like, aggressive operator, so that way if they do try to hit site, he has a better gun and just a more, like, maneuverable operator, so he can, like, move around inside the bomb site. Mm-hmm. Open has a lot of, like, natural cover that the map, like, delivers by itself. So, you know, being a 3-speed compared to a 3-armor there, you know, can be the difference in winning or losing a round. And then us bringing some more traps and more, again, more mobile operators on the top floor just in case they want to hit other parts of the map so we can rotate more quickly and stuff like that. But I think it's the only changes we made. I think I went to, like, Frost, and then Nate Rampy took Oryx instead of Castle, and we dropped the Pulse.
So you guys have been struggling a little bit on the attacks in the past, but today's attacks I think were the cleanest bank attacks I've seen in a very long time. What has changed? Like, what was the what's changed, basically?
I think it's a little map dependent. I mean, we've played a lot of Cafe this season. When we played Border, our attacks were pretty decent. Chalet, I think, to everyone's surprise, has kind of changed the way it's played a lot. So that map can be deceivingly defender-sided right now. Even in scrims, you've seen similar results to what we had with Mirage, where it's been defender-sided. And then Bank, I feel like, is pretty balanced. I feel like he can go either way. For us, it's like, I feel like it's a very 50-50 map. Like, our defenses and our attacks are about on the same level on that map. And then Cafe, I think that map is just really hard to attack sometimes. Like, that map can just be a pain.
Well, speaking of attacks, everyone knows that you guys are really fond of running Ying, yet the ban that comes from Astralis is Zoph instead, which means Sabana's still up and plenty of other operators are still there, and Ying is probably, like, a primary reason for why you were able to win those attacks so effectively. What was your reaction when you saw that, and why do you think that was what they went with?
I don't know if you guys saw this on stream, but when the game started, they banned Zofia. I looked at Callout, and I laughed, like, you guys love Ying up? And I laughed at him. And here we are.
Nothing more needs to be said. I mean, getting the win, Space Station crushing it today. Congrats, Yeti, on the victory. Good luck next week, and thanks for chatting with us.
Thank you so much. You guys have a great day.
You too. All right.
That's my boy.
Yeti from Space Station Gaming with the 7-2 stomp of Astralis. I mean, like Eddie said, Astralis, obviously, you know, still looking at going to SI, still looking at probably having the points they need to do that, but no doubt this one hurts. I mean, we saw Callout sitting there behind the players at the end of that one. He was clearly not happy.
He was slouched and saying nothing.
Those competitors, those players are competitors too. They are not satisfied with losses, so I do kind of still wonder what's going on with that squad.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing to point out though is their cost. They're not getting traded. I think that SSG traded beautifully, especially on their attacks. Whereas, you know, Astralis was going for the trades, but I don't think they really got any.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point. Typically, you take a player that has, like, high kills, and that's, like, expected to have high costs. But Hot and Cold, 4-3, 100% cost. He's staying alive. If he does die, he's getting traded, or he's getting one of those picks when he does end up going down in the round. So it's nice to see that from SSG. They also won all but one opening engagement. So you can tell they really dominated this this map
here. I mean, I'm confused by Astralis' overall plan. They understand that if SSG are a phenomenal team playing for trades, then you have to do the same thing yourself. That was a big reason for why they won that Parabellum game so effectively. They played those trades really well. There wasn't a single time that you'd notice SSG got an opening kill on Parabellum. Parabellum had an answer for it. So Astralis probably followed a very similar routine, yet their only real response in this game was just going faster. They decided if it's an all, like a together push all at the same time, that's the thing that's gonna win. Sometimes it was the beginning of a round, sometimes it's delayed a little bit, so maybe it's not the expected play, but you notice several times, landslide of kills. It's suddenly a 5v2 out of nowhere, or like a 4v1 within like about 30 seconds of Astralis actually making that same push. It felt like that was the only answer, and there was nothing on the opposite side of the ball where they actually made the half switch and tried defending against a Ying heavy attack from SSG. I don't really know what Astralis' game plan was at all.
Yeah, I mean, it was also just great execution from Space Station, right? Like Penguin said, you know, some of the best attacks you said you've seen on Bank in a long time.
They're clean.
Speaking of some of the best play we've seen in a long time from Space Station, we got round 5. Jesse's going to telestrate it for us. So head on over there.
Get over there.
And break it down for us.
No, this will not be a squeaky clean attack, but this will be a pretty solid defense. And particularly, I want to highlight the frost play that we saw from Space Station on this bomb site from Rampy. We'll play it so that we can get into the building and actually take a look at where those frost mats are placed up. Right here, we got a good angle. So there's the first one that you can see inside here of the stock, and you can imagine how this one's gonna play out. You may remember as well, but there's also one at the very top of these staircases, which is gonna be a kind of an awkward angle to try to shoot at if you were an attacker with a gun at the top of these staircases. And there's one kind of here on the banana part of the map, kind of out in the open, not really near a window, but it is somewhat surprising. And I think what you really want to understand about this is that frost mats are not just being used to down careless players who jump inside of windows, but they can provide real obstacles for the attack. Obviously, Astralis, they're trying to push a solo Monty up lobby stairs. There's not a whole lot Monty can do, though, with that frost mat there, because Yeti's also, of course, playing right next to it. If Forrest tries to shoot that frost mat, he's going to have to put a shield down, going to be very exposed to Yeti. So it makes it a very difficult problem for the Monty to try to work around. We'll see how he does, in fact, actually get through that. He's going to have to expend some of this utility in order to make that happen. He's going to back off at first, toss in a couple of those smoke grenades that get caught by the magnets that will cover him, though, and that allows him to bolt the gun out, take down the frost mat. Now, at the same time, you might have just witnessed it down at the bottom. We actually had a player jump into the frost mat, and sometimes that's how they're going to be used, right? Sometimes that is how it ends up going. When you've got a team like Astralis that you know is going to go kind of fast, that you know is going to push you, might be a little careless with their drones. You can get away with that. Notice as well how important it is to help Faults play this position. With this player no longer a threat, he can focus down the long hallway around the janitor door there and be able to play around the shield. It's such a powerful spot for Oumai to play. We see it from many, many teams, and it ends up being a very clean round from from SSG all in all. Thought it was a bit of an interesting use of the frost in this case particularly. I want to showcase you guys in case you want to rock some frost on your plays on Bank top floor.
Always do it, because frost 1.5 is back, baby. That was the main reason why I stopped playing Frost, was they took the best scope off one of the better guns. And I think she's probably still heavily underrated, but I like that she's kind of seeing even more incorporation now after we got that change again. Not many people are saying Frost is a bad op anymore. Remember when she was memed on?
Yeah, I think Frost is more on par with Alibi now. She has the 1.5, has the shield, kind of has like a similar util. You put it in front of windows to give you information. And I mean, we saw it work.
Hey. No kidding, yeah. Wins in action from it. And we got another round to check out as well. This one's going to be round number 7. We talked about the Ying getting through, ended up being very impactful, perhaps no more so than this round that we're going to take a look at.
Yeah, probably one of the most perfect Ying smoke executes on this site you are ever going to see, and also proof that you probably shouldn't play it on defense. Here's what's going to end up happening. They've got a Ying. Again, this was not banned. Astralis decided this wasn't worth it enough to actually ban, and SSG love playing it. 4 people on SSG are about to get on rappel and are about to hold different positions against Astralis for this entire round. And the one guy who isn't going to be on rappel for the whole round is Bosco, because he's going to go in playing Lion. At the same time, candelas go off and smokes cover all of the necessary angles. He's going to go right into the bottom left-hand corner of your screen inside CEO and plant almost immediately, while every other member of SSG holds different angles and ensures that no one from Astralis actually like gets a quick window peek, actually makes a jump out, tries to make a play. This is why this site is such an annoyance, such a nuisance to try and defend properly if you have so much reliance on the players who were on the windows themselves. So it takes a second to get going, but Astralis are already prepared for some window play. I don't think they're prepared for how clean of a take this is overall.
Yeah, I think like in these positions right now, like Astralis feels very suffocated. There's window pressure from lobby, there's window pressure from CEO, and it's a matter of time before an execute happens. And I mean, we're gonna see it soon enough, I think. Where Bosco gets into like the deep corner, they have no information. The only information op they have is the Mira and a BP,
yep.
Which just isn't enough on CEO, especially yeah. with the smoke.
Like they're not playing a Warden here in Janitor either to like hold the long angle. Here come the smokes. Lion charge the exact same time. Bosco goes right in. Bottom left-hand corner, usually there's a drone hole right there. Sometimes you can't get shot through it, but the smoke has already covered off that part of it. And the kills now come out as Astralis tried to move in to stop this plant from going down. They fail, and now Bosco is the only one who is ever going to enter this map at any point in time for Space Station. He'll be able to hold different angles, and for the entire rest of this round, all SSG have to do is wait for Astralis to come into their crosshairs.
But thank God there's no Zofia, because what would you do without those explosives and stuns? You only have explosives on Lion and Finca and Ash and Habana, and you only have stuns on Lion, Finca, Habana, and also Ying. So really, that's utility that you're not having on the board, okay?
Why waste Elementary. A ban yeah. on a Zoph in 2022? This isn't like 2020 where we decided we needed to take more fragging power off the table. I think a Zoe ban is something that we saw Sonics do from forever ago. Not the same situation, not the same meta. Don't do that against a Space Station team that loves playing Ying.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
There you go. Lessons learned, maybe something Astralis can take into next week. For now, Space Station becomes our first victor of the day here, the last day of week three, in stage three. Don't go anywhere, though, because the day's just getting started. Our next match is going to be TSM taking on Exet. It is going to be action-packed, and it will happen when we return on the Rainbow Six North American League right after this.